Me baby, never let me go. Well, good morning, Atlanta. You're listening to the Saturday edition of Doo-Wop and Rhythm, and I'm your host, DJ Gene Tompkins, bringing you some of the best memories of your life. So sit back for the next 3 hours and enjoy those memories that you can cherish. Right now, the legendary Chords. Oh, I love you.
Life could be a dream. Life could be a dream. Life could be a dream if I could take you up in paradise up above. If you would tell me I'm the only one that you love, life could be a dream, sweetheart.
Life could be a dream, sweetheart. And in 1954, life was. It was the year the Supreme Court ruled that segregated education was illegal. I Love Lucy captured the hearts of America. TV dinners were a quick success, and the first issue of Sports Illustrated was published. The cost of a new home was $10,225, and steak was 91 cents a pound. The New York Giants won the World Series, and Bill Vukovich wowed him at the Indy 500. Picture of the year went to On the Waterfront. Marlon Brando also took home an Oscar for his portrayal of Terry Molloy. June of that same year marked the anniversary of the first recorded earthquake in the U.S., the Plymouth Plantation earthquake of 1638. It may not have been the first, but it would certainly not be the last. Five young musicians from New York exploded on the charts. The Chords set the world on fire and secured their rightful place in music history. It all began for the Chords in this neighborhood in the South Bronx. In these streets, visible only in the mind's eye, the ghosts of teenage a cappella groups huddled on the street corners.
One of the things that came across strongly to me from talking to Buddy was the sense of community in the Bronx at that time. The success that the Chords achieved through Shaboom was feted and was celebrated in the community. And I suppose going out from there and travelling across the country to come back again to the Bronx at that time gave them a great sense of achievement as well.
Their magic carried into the night, and their presence illuminated with crisp clarity by the glistening half moon. Velvety voices that galvanized and forever imprinted the urban tapestry of the city. It was a simpler time, a time when matters were not always settled with fists, but with something more powerful, the gift of song. It was a time of finger snapping and harmonizing. Before fans were dancing in the aisles, they were cheering from fire escapes. There are 101 stories on the way to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. None quite as unique as the boys who started it all.
In 1952, we were all singing on the street corners at that time with different groups. Our first tenor, Jimmy Keys, he was singing with a group called the Four Notes. Carl Feaster and Claude Feaster, they were brothers. They were singing with a group called the Tune Toppers. I was singing with a group called the Keynotes at the time. And we had our bass singer. His name was William Edwards. We called him Ricky. He was singing with a group called the Chords, which we took the name to use at a later time. And we used to ride around in my old car. I had a old Buick, then convertible. We used to ride around in that. And we used to rehearse in it and sing in it, and we had a lot of fun. And in fact, we wrote Shaboom in the car.
No one could have predicted what was about to happen. It was a million to one shot. Five young guys from the Bronx lit the rock and roll fuse and made history with a Shaboom. You could argue that music was impregnated with the seed of rock and roll in the back seat of Buddy McRae's Buick convertible. It was there on a sweltering summer night, leaning against a pronounced dashboard and sticking to the leather upholstery, the Chords wrote their groundbreaking anthem and deflowered the innocence of popular music. like hundreds of fair maidens of the day who forfeited their virginity for a boom, boom, boom and a bang, bang, bang. It hurts so good.
Oh, if you're a guy who's had a gal and each and every port, and you forgot the rules of love.
After Carl and his brother came along and got into the group, then he had brought the idea with him about Shaboom. And plus, Carl Feaster had he was our lead singer. He had a way of singing that he added a lot of stuff in, like boom boom and bang bang and different things like that. I think that's really what really started the whole Shaboom thing.
You know, back in 1954 when the Chords recorded Shaboom, that did the whole change. That changed the rock and roll music from the rhythm and blues music, which it was at that time. But when the Chords had come out with Shaboom, what happened at that time was it just changed the whole idea of what music was about. It went from R&B to rock and roll, because then it gave a cross country and a cross section of all people dancing to that music the Chords put out, Shaboom.
Historians considered Shaboom the first rock and roll record. Hell, Shaboom was so popular, it was used as a promotional song for Robert Wagner's election campaign for mayor of New York.
Music sort of changes in stages over a number of years, and I think you really have to look at the end of World War II when an awful lot of African Americans who'd served in the war came back expecting greater freedom like they'd had in the services, and didn't find what they really wanted. But on the arts front, or the music front, some things started to change with groups like the Ravens and the Orioles, the vocal groups, the early Bird groups. And music, black music was now starting to be written by younger African Americans for younger African Americans. And in this time, you also have sort of the rise of people like Louis Jordan, Miss Timpani Five, meaning that you have the demise of the big bands. You have small groups starting to take over economically. Big bands couldn't travel anymore. It didn't make any sense. And you start to see the prototype of the early jump R&B groups. And it was happy times. People were glad the war was over. And a lot of this music got to be about partying. And it got to be very danceable. And so in the early 50s and late 40s, you start to see the coming together of cultures and races over jump R&B. So as we often talk about here in Cleveland with the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, Alan Freed recognized that. That's the reason he went on the air in 51 and started playing Rhythm and Blues, and then subsequently renamed it Rock and Roll. It's an African-American term, been around for 100 years, but renamed it to allow it, hopefully, to reach a broader audience. And he was absolutely right. His show became very, very popular. And this black jump music, which is, weren't virtually no white artists at that point in time in 51 doing this music, really took off. White kids started listening to it. More black kids started listening to it. So right about the time Shaboom comes out with the Chords, you really are starting to see a transition of music. These are songs that really started to change the landscape. They were moving music from Tin Pan Alley and ASCAP and from black America over into white America and BMI and small record labels and producers and writers and artists nobody had ever heard of.
See, in the early 50s, when we go back, we think about the Orioles back in 1948, when they recorded It's Too Soon to Know. Now, that was like the first rhythm and blues music to come out. But however, it was sort of in an era that nobody had known what to do with it. They didn't know where to put it. They didn't know anything about it. But when the Chords had come out with Shaboom, the song Shaboom was so powerful and so strong, it appealed to everyone, all races, all creeds, all over the world.
It's not like people have said about us that we just got discovered singing in the subway. It's not so. We had to go down and we sang in Oscar Cohen's office. And he, in turn, referred us, like I said, to Atlantic. And then they wanted us to record a song called Cross Over the Bridge. I didn't think, they didn't seem to be too happy with the song called Shaboom at that time because it was so different. And I guess they thought maybe it wasn't worth the effort. But they liked our sound, and so that's what we did. We decided we would go with them, and we did. And we recorded Cross Over the Bridge, and But in turn, they had to let us record Shaboom because we weren't going to be satisfied unless we got Shaboom recorded. And that was the beginning of the Chords. When we first went to California, we went out there to visit some of the disc jockeys. This disc jockey, his name was Huggy Boy.
Guy over there in California, because as you know, each state had their sort of a thing about what rock and roll or what rhythm and blues was all about. And Huggy Boy happened to be the West Coast guy. Very popular, had a great audience out there. And the thing about him was he would always turn a record over to the B-side to see what it would sound like. And the thing about Shaboom, when they've had gone, when actually the song was Cross Over the Bridge, the A-side, when Huggy Boy turned it over on the other side, they had to play it about four or five times. And people calling up and wanting to know, what's that song? Who's that singing, you know? And that's how he really broke the record. He broke the record.
Dick Williams is his name, but we all called him Huggy Boy. And he liked Shaboom, so I think out of curiosity one night, he decided he would turn it over. And when he turned it over, it was just like a miracle happened. The people went wild, and the song took off like a rocket. And as we know, the rest is history.
Huggy Boy is considered a spin master of Los Angeles pop culture. He even introduced Elvis Presley during the King's first California gig in 1956 at the Pan Pacific Auditorium. What possessed the DJ to flip that record over and give Shaboom its unintentional debut? Was it simply a cosmic accident, or something much more? Was he a pawn to a preordained mission by the musical powers that be?
Somehow we turned that song over, which had a standard that Patty Page had originally made, and it was on Atlantic Records, I believe. And I just played it a couple of times. It was an instant hit, back in this day, about 2 days because of the airplay. But of course, this is way back in the 50s, and we were broadcasting from a big, big record store, and it just caught on.
It was just phenomenal. I mean, they just, everybody had never heard it before, never heard this type of harmony, you know, this type of five-part harmony that was out there. You know, the guys who was doing it with Shaboom and all the tunes, they just knocked them out, absolutely. And you know, in the Apollo Theater, if you're not right, you might as well forget about it. They knocked them out.
Well, everybody was afraid to go to the Apollo. The Apollo has a bad reputation for discouraging people that want to be singers. So, but we had our nerve up, and we were the headliners at the Apollo, in fact. This is our first headlining job. And the people seemed to accept us very well there. We did a couple of funny tunes, and they really enjoyed. And then when we came along with Shaboom, that really did it.
The Apollo Theater in the heart of New York City on 125th Street needs no introduction. Where stars are born and legends are made. Since 1934, the Apollo has launched the careers of artists like Ella Fitzgerald, James Brown, Michael Jackson, and Lauryn Hill, just to name a few of its dazzling alumni. The Apollo is a cornerstone of pop culture, a towering symbol of brilliance and artistic achievement.
It was a great time. It gave, you know, well, for instance, the Chords, when they made Shaboom, they went further than most of the groups. Most of the groups, when they had a hit, they went to the Apollo Theater, the Howard Theater, the Baltimore Theater, the Royal, all those theaters. And these guys went straight to California, to the Crescendo, and all those big-time places. Played on top of the four tunes who had about five or six hits at the time, and they were getting the Chords were getting top billing over them. So it was really, it just changed the industry to me, period. And then after that, there were more rhythm-type songs coming on and novelty songs. But that was a great time.
The Shrine, as a lot of people probably know today, they have all of the Oscars and all of that there now. But at that time, they only had the rock and roll. And it was a very big place. And so on our first trip to California, we went to the Shrine, and I forgot, it was maybe around 8,000-10,000 people there. The biggest crowd we'd ever sang before in our life. And I think we were all a little shaky at that time because this is our very first gig. And so it turned out great. The people didn't want us to go off the stage. They kept yelling for more and more and more. And it turned out to be a wonderful, wonderful thing.
Just like sawing off shirts.
As the Chords enjoyed their meteoric rise and continued to tread where no group had gone before, waters became murky, their direction unfocused at best. Trouble was that no one knew anything about rock and roll, not even the record companies and their executives. It was 1954 BE, before Elvis. The group's personal fears and apprehensions were intensifying.
Well, you see, the thing about the Chords music, it was not, the Chords was, say, for example, you hear the high lows and different groups like that. The Chords used to listen to groups like that when they were singing. They always wanted for that perfect harmony. That's why they got the name the Chords. And the thing about it was that they actually specialized in having sort of a jazz sound. But that jazz sound turned out to be something that was just so unique until it became something that everyone wanted to emulate.
From those who were looking after them in business terms or in management terms, they could have fared much better. The manager they were allocated, if you like, at the time, his background really was in the black one-nighter circuit. And for them to break into something broader, you know, was very difficult. And of course, one of the great achievements was they were probably the first black vocal group to get on nationwide, coast-to-coast, primetime television, variety television. They achieved a lot, but perhaps with better management, they could have achieved much more. A lot of it was down to management, both personal management of artists and management of record companies, which were in for the quick dollar, the quick buck, and didn't care very much whether the group went on and had another hit, because there was another group around the corner and they were going to bring them in, get something new again, and you know, make money off that. I don't think they should have been simply a one-hit wonder. They should have been perhaps better managed. And they weren't, it wasn't a manipulated record. So there was a potential there to do much more. I think they deserved much more.
That was my favorite group. You know, I used to go to all the rehearsals, and it fascinated me because Carl Feist was one of the best, I think one of the best lead singers ever in the history of that music. And it's just a shame that they didn't have hit after hit after hit like they would have, you know, if things had been different.
Atlantic Records did nothing for them after Shaboom. And then when they tried to go into the other companies, they put an injunction on them and they could not record anything. And that's the reason why the Chords did not go as to be one of the, you know, well-known groups of all time. Not because of their music. It was really because of the record companies.
Oh, bless you.
Chords enjoyed unprecedented record sales in spite of a country divided. Racial tensions were escalating throughout the 50s and 60s. The Supreme Court's landmark decision in the case of Brown versus Board of Education of Topeka, Kansas, found that separate educational facilities were unconstitutional. Desegregation met with strong resistance. Martin Luther King Jr. led a boycott in Montgomery, Alabama, giving rise to the civil rights movement. The far-reaching tentacles of profound prejudice impacted the microcosm of the music business and ultimately the fate of many black artists.
In the early days of the rock and roll era, the racism was very, very rough. And in our first trip to California, we decided we would go swimming. And we stopped at the swimming pool. And so all the kids in the swimming pool, they were predominantly white. But we had the name written on the car. It said The Chords on the car. So naturally, they knew the name because they knew the song, because the song was so big in California then. And so as we decided to go swimming, all the kids gathered around, wanted to know, were we the Chords? They said, no, you're not the Chords. The Chords are white. And we tried to tell them that, yes, we are the Chords. And so the only way we could convince them, we had to sing Shaboom before we went into the pool, so they could hear it and they could hear the difference, the likeness, or rather, as far as the record was concerned. And after that, it was smooth sailing for the rest of the day.
There were difficulties over getting airtime or airplay on radio stations. There were difficulties in terms of where black artists could appear and could perform. Even in terms of large theaters, there was a circuit there of maybe half a dozen: the Apollo in New York, the Howard in Washington, the Royal in Baltimore, the Regal in Chicago, and artists could go around those. But that was essentially black artists performing for black audiences. It was quite difficult to actually make that transition over into a white market. I think one of the things about the Chords that perhaps enabled that was that Shaboom itself had quite a light sound, and they didn't sound like a black group, and so that might have made them a bit more acceptable.
Suddenly you start to get these R&B records, because they're so danceable and they're so much fun and they're so much more attractive to a younger audience, that they started to cross over into the pop charts. I think one of the unique things about the Chords, first of all, they wrote the song, which is not always the case, and they also kept the rights, publishing rights to the song, which is a wonderful thing. They wrote the song, and it's a very generic, happy tune about love and the times they live in. And I say that because some of the other crossover records, because they were double entendre, risque, as they call it, rhythm and blues records, they were, even though they were being bought by white people and played in their houses, often they weren't played on white radio.
By the mid-50s, the independent labels were dominating the R&B charts. The majors counterattacked by covering their records. Now, the cover was meant to appeal to the widest possible market. The cover versions retained the same melody and tempo, but had cleaner lyrics. The record would appeal to both adults and teenagers. In most cases, the cover's sound quality was superior, which gave them an advantage in the marketplace. These inferior cover versions would also receive more airplay. The Crew Cuts were a Toronto-based vocal group and Mercury Records' king of cover groups. The Crew Cuts took aim at Shaboom.
Covering songs in the early part of the rock and roll era was nothing unusual. Like I said, the racism it was the cause of all of that. I think, well, the Crew Cuts, they covered Shaboom, and they took it to number one because they were a white group. And not only did the Chords get caught up in that, but every other R&B artist that came along at that time, they got caught up in it too.
the song, although again, it written by one of the group members, but in fact there was a cooperative effort there. It had a snappiness, it had a jazziness about it. It also had a sort of an optimism about it, and that was a new sound. It was something new that certainly white listeners hadn't heard before. The other thing about the chords was they weren't a heavily black sound. They weren't what you would call sort of heavy sort of race music. They had a lightness about them, and yet a jazziness. And the irony was that when it was covered by a white group, the crew cuts, it lost that zip, it lost that zing. And it's difficult to put your finger on, but the cover really didn't work at all.
An interesting note, the crew cuts were inducted into the Canadian Music Hall of Fame in 1984, yet they never had a single original hit of their own.
Well, you see, the music at that time, when the chords recorded Shaboom, they were like a first. So what happened, had become a thing for the record companies to bring in people like the crew cuts to try to get the big hits out of it. I mean, and then when you look at it, at the same token, too, the crew cuts did help expand it into all races, too, as well, because the chords, you know, made the song first, and that's the whole thing. As long as you know where it actually come from, that's the thing that you really want to know about. The cause was the first to do it.
It just happened to be a smart hit. I've learned in the last 50 years that I've been playing music on the radio, you just can't make a hit, no matter how many times you play it. It has to be a natural hit. And that's what that was, a natural hit.
To further ensure the success of these cover versions, the major labels raised post-production efforts through expensive marketing and press, pushing the cover versions to mega-hit status. In truth, the covers were merely watered-down and whitewashed versions of the originals. The Chords struggled for identity and continued to produce original songs under a different name. In 1955, the Chords reinvented themselves as the Chord Cats and recorded A Girl to Love and Hold Me Baby. But as the record companies found their footing under all the sudden success that was doo-wop, the more thankless the industry became to its pioneers. Banished, yes, but never forgotten.
I think it confused people because they didn't know who the Chord Cats were from the Chords, plus then we had to change the name from that, from the Chord Cats, we went to the Shabooms. We figured that would be more something that people would recognize, you know, so I think it did hurt the group as a whole.
Often, you know, record companies, once they had a hit record, sometimes with a group, they would formulaically create the same record over again with a different title, so it sounded like the same. Sometimes it worked, often it didn't. Sometimes they would, occasionally you'd have to renegotiate with a group because once they had a hit, they'd want more rights or more money on the next record, so there was less incentive for the label to push it. But I think just in general, there was so much material coming out at that time that and so many people breaking records, it's just luck of the draw. Some of these records just did not get the airplay they deserved. And because they weren't heard, you know, people just never had a chance to buy them.
Follow-ups and so forth to Shaboom just weren't handled. There were legal wrangles over the name of the group. Lots of things could have been perhaps better taken care of. But despite all of that, they achieved a great deal. And it's because they achieved so much in difficult circumstances that we need to, they deserve recognition. We need to recognize those first steps that they took on that path.
At the same time, the Chords were on the same labels and the same company as the Drifters and the Coasters. So maybe some of the politics that got in the way was the fact that they had two vocal groups that were basically very much and very popular and had sort of taken off. And was there really room for another one? Could the label really support or promote a third group, you know, as much as they should or could? I don't know.
I think it really hurts now more than ever because now that we look back on the times that this came along, in fact, it's not just us. It's a lot of the doo-wop groups that came along during our era that hasn't gotten any credit even till today. And you look at your halls of fame, particularly the one in Ohio, they only have certain people in there, and we're the ones that actually created the interest in the rock and roll era. And so, I don't know. I think we're all still hurt behind that. We have so many different opinions on the rock and roll era. Some people started in one particular place, some people started in other places, and some people started with Rock Around the Clock, which came along in 55. And so it's very difficult to know, you know, what the historians think. And a lot of the books I've read, they do give the Chords credit to some extent. They seem to think that Shaboom was one of the very first rock and roll record.
In recent years, 50s doo-wop has exploded back into the music scene. This renaissance, this blast from the past, is due in part to the tireless efforts of such music preservation societies as the UGHA and the Rhythm and Blues Foundation. These music aficionados meet with only one goal in mind: to recognize the outstanding achievement of these original artists and to give thanks to the unforgettable imprint they made and continue to make on the American culture.
Gentlemen, the Chords!
There's so many firsts here. They're firsts in terms of a black group crossing over into the white market. There's the first in terms of the song itself, and there's the first in terms of that whole era, that being a starting point for rock and roll music. They were trailblazers. They were a group who started it all. They came up with a song. They created the song themselves. They came up with a song which has become almost a soundtrack for an era, a soundtrack for the mid-50s. It's immediately recognizable. They trailblazed a road for a lot of other artists, for a lot of other vocal groups, for a lot of black artists. As one of the first groups there, they deserve recognition.
Well, I get asked that question all the time about everybody from groups of last week to blues artists from the 30s or 40s. And it's always a difficult question. Unlike baseball or football or basketball, there are no real statistics that we look at. The only criteria to be inducted in the Hall of Fame is you had to have a record 25 years ago under your name. Maybe there's a category there that we need, and we talk about it, but we'd have to change our bylaws. It would allow us to have a committee that looks at songs that were instrumental or pivotal or sort of the vanguard of music, and really the world of rock and roll, the world of popular music, as we know it, wouldn't be the same without songs like G or Shaboom or In the Still Night. So I think there's a possibility something like this could happen.
Well, the Hall of Fame, I'm not sure exactly where we fit in with them, but I would think that when you speak of history, you try to start at the beginning. And I think I've said that before many times, that you can't tell history by starting in the middle. You have to start at the very beginning. And the doo-wop singers were the beginning of the rock era.
Well, you see, the sad thing about the Hall of Fame is politics today, and quite naturally, there are so many qualified people who should have been in the Hall of Fame for the accomplishments, but they're not. The Chords, without a doubt, if, as you said before, if not the group, the song, because the song was so unique and the song was so important to the music that we have today.
The song should definitely be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And that was that's a song that, see, that song was really big. Everybody covered it. I think Stan Freberg did a comedy version of it. The Crew Cuts cut it. I think Billy Williams cut it. A lot of people recorded it in 1954. So it was a real super hit. It was like, I would say, in comparison to Thriller back in 82 or 83 or something like that, it was the same type thing, you know. A smash, and it should be in the Hall of Fame.
Well, UGHA, which is the United Group Harmony Association, they did induct us into their Hall of Fame. And we thought that that was beautiful. And what really made it great was that a couple of the guys were still alive before when this happened. So we all got a chance to share in that particular pride. And a couple of the guys had already passed away, and now I'm the only one left of the original group. So it makes me very proud to be a part of this.
Little maiden, you're crowding all my dreams. Little maiden, you're ruining all my schemes. Why did you enslave me at a time like this? Little maiden, you're crowding all my dreams. Little maiden, you're ruining all my skin.
Doo-wop is as exciting as ever. Nowadays, you don't have to look too hard to find Buddy McRae, the last surviving member of the Chords, beaming with pride that Shaboom has endured the test of time. He has one long-standing birthday wish, however: to see the Chords inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Then life truly would be a dream. And when he finally decides to blow out the candles on his musical legacy, it would be with great contentment. A remarkable piece of history.
Well, I think the happiest day of my life would be if we were inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in Ohio. But I think it would be a lot happier if all of the fellows were here, not just me alone. But I guess I'll have to be happy for all of us and for our families and their families too.
I always say that the things that the people and the artists that deserve to get in, I think almost all of them get in eventually in time. Unfortunately, it's not always in the time that their fans or the group wants. So that's sometimes the sad part.
And quite often we get to a situation where we don't recognize people in time. We recognize them when there are no longer any surviving members. And that's not the case with the Chords. I say, let's recognize the Chords while we still have a surviving original member.
Look what you've done to me. Helpless as I can be. So much in love with you.
And it should be in the Hall of Fame.
I think there's a possibility something like this could happen.
The Chords, without a doubt.
They deserve recognition. We need to recognize those first steps that they took.
And they should be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
But anyway, I thought history was supposed to be about the beginning of things, not the end. And I've always felt that if you want to tell the truth about history, you have to start at the beginning. Life could be a dream if I could take you up in paradise up above and tell you, darling, you're the only one that I love. Life could be a dream, sweetheart, hello, hello again. Shaboom, and hoping we meet again, boom, boom, boom. De-ding-dong, a-lang, a-lang, a-lang. Whoa, whoa, bip, fa-de-bo-do-ba-dip. Whoa, life could be a dream if all my precious plans would come true.
And we'd be left to tell my whole life loving you. Life could be a dream, sweetheart.
Every time I look at you, something is on my mind. If you do what I want you to, maybe we'd be so fine.
Oh, life could be a dream. Shaboom, if I could take you up in paradise up above. Shaboom, then tell me, darling, I'm the only one that you love. Life could be a dream. Sweetheart, hello, hello again. Shaboom, and hope we meet again. Boom, boom, boom. Shaboom, if I could take you up in paradise up above. Shaboom, and tell me, darling, I'm the only one that you love. Life could be a dream, sweetheart, hello, hello again. Shaboom, and hope we meet again, boom, boom, boom. Ding-dong, ding-dong, la-lang-a-la-lang-a-la-lang-a-la-lang-a-la-oh, oh, bip, a-bip-a-do-ba-dip. Oh, life could be a dream, life could be a dream. Do-do-do-do, shaboom.